inshallah, we are beginning in less than 5 minutes, inshallah. Yes? Yeah, this is for them, not for you. You don't listen from the speaker, you listen from here. I will raise my voice. Testing. The audio is okay? Inshallah. Okay. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Alhamdulillah. As-salatu was-salamu ala Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa tabi'ahu hudah ma ba'd. As-salamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Jazakumullah khairah for making it today to talk about an important issue that happened on the 24th of September, the first day of Eid, the 10th of Dhul Hijjah. But the talk will not be actually about that day in particular. It will be about something more. It will be about something more important, something bigger. But what we will try to do is to see the connection. Connect the dots that many people are failing to do so. And to do that, we are starting from the current situation that is taking place in Mecca every year. How many of you, if I asked, how many of you have been to Mecca, whether for Hajj or Umrah? But to be specific, for Hajj, mashallah, a lot of people. Yeah, it's safe to say more than 50%. You've been to Mecca and you've performed Hajj, alhamdulillah. Yes. If I asked you, generally, a general question, what do you think of the efforts that are done there to organize the Hajj? Would you say it is weak? Or good or very good?
Very good.
Who says weak? Why? Yeah. No much improvement.
Yes. From the, because I went to Hajj in
2000.
And recently I went this year.
Yes. Really? From 2000, 15 years, you didn't see the change? Okay, well.
In spite of the Masjid al-Haram improvements.
Yes.
But in terms of traffic, in terms of.
What about the train? What about the Jamarat? You see how it was in 2000 and
no,
now?
There's no. Of course, in terms of religious, but in terms of people.
People. Well. I will talk about that, actually, in terms of people. Now, first of all, I'm not from Saudi, I'm Syrian. Yes, I did study there, and I love Mecca and Medina, and every Muslim loves Mecca and Medina. And I disagree with many things that they believe, the Saudis generally. But I have to tell the truth. Personally, I would say that what they are doing is very good. It's not only good, very good. Is it excellent where it is perfect? No, of course not. There are always areas of improvement. But if you go there, you see the efforts from the people, from the officials, that they are really doing a good job. There is a dedicated institute for research just to receive ideas from people and to see how they could implement that. Honestly, if any country, now not talking about European countries or first world countries, but any Muslim country other than Saudi that is in control of Hajj, I don't think they would do the job that is done by them. This is my personal testimony. We may agree or disagree, that's okay, but honestly, I feel that the efforts are done there. They are more than good. They are doing their best. Can they do more? Yes. Are there areas of improvement? Yes. Okay, now, coming to what happened. This is not an isolated incident, by all means. What happened in Mecca on the first day of Eid, 1436, this is no isolated incident by any means. Here is a brief, not a full list, of some of the crimes that were committed by the Shia in Mecca. In year 312, you see how early this was? Abu Tahir al-Qurmuti. His name was Abu Tahir al-Qurmuti. What did he do? He came to Mecca during the season of Hajj. He waited until the Hajjaj finished their pilgrim. He took all their money. He took their children and women and waited until they are 40 kilometers away from Mecca in the desert. Left the men only, did not kill them, but left them to die from thirst and hunger. This is in year 312. Who is saying that? Have you heard of Imam Ibn Kathir? Imam Ibn Kathir, rahimahullah, he has a book of history called Al-Bidayah wa Nihaya. He is the one who said, in this year, because he chronicled the years of the Islamic history, he said, in the year 312, in that year, Abu Tahir al-Qurmuti, la'anahu Allah wa la'ana abah. May Allah curse him and curse his father for what he did. That's what he did. Then, the same one, Abu Tahir al-Qurmuti, al-Janabi, that's his name. He was the leader of a sect from the Shia called Qaramita. Qaramita, they are a sect from the Shia, extreme sect. Extreme group from the Shia lived in Hajar. Hajar in Eastern Arabian Peninsula, in what is known in our time as Al-Ahsa, Al-Hafuf. In that area, he lived there. They lived there, Al-Qaramita. They came in the year 317 again. What did he do this time? He did not wait until Hajj was over. On the day of Eid, he killed the pilgrims, threw them in the well of Zamzam. He stood on the door of the Kaaba and chanted, "Ana billahi wa billahi ana. Allahu yuhyi al-khalqa wa ufnihim ana. I am by Allah and Allah is by me. Allah creates the creation and I kill them." That's what he was saying. And he killed the pilgrims. He destroyed the dome on the top of the well of Zamzam. There used to be a dome, like a sign. He destroyed that after he threw the pilgrims. After that, he asked for the black stone. And it was taken. The black stone was taken for 22 years. from Mecca to Hajar. During that time, one of the great imams, his name is Al-Khiraqi, Al-Imam Al-Khiraqi. Yes, you can. Imam Al-Khiraqi wrote a text in the Hanbali school of thought. We have well-known schools of thought. We have Shafi'i school of thought. We have Hanafi school of thought. In the Hanbali school of thought, the school of thought of Imam Ahmad, the largest book of fiqh, the biggest book of fiqh is called Al-Mughni for Imam Ibn Qudama. Al-Mughni Sharh Mukhtasar Al-Khiraqi. Commentary on Al-Khiraqi. That Imam Al-Khiraqi, when did he die? He died in the year 334. During that time. 334. Because the Black Stone was not back until year 339. What did he say? He was talking about the book of Hajj. He said, the acts of Hajj, when you start the tawaf, to kiss the Black Stone, وَيُقَبِّلُ الْحَجَرَ الْأَسْوَدَ إِنْ كَانْ, if it was there. People, when they read that, they wonder, what does it mean, إِنْ كَانْ? What does it mean, إِنْ كَانْ? إِنْ وُجِدَ. So, Imam Ibn Qudama, when he came to the commentary, he mentioned the fact that during his time, when he was writing his book, the Black Stone was not there. For 22 years, it wasn't there. Where was it? It was in Eastern Arabian Peninsula. When the Black Stone was taken, the Prince of Mecca, he went with soldiers, with the people, his family. He told him, take all the money, take everything, but keep the Black Stone, don't take it. He said, you want the Black Stone? Wait. He came out of his tent and he killed him and he killed all the soldiers. And he left with that. Not only this, he started asking, أَيْنَ الْحِجَارَ مِنْ سِجِّيلِ أَيْنَ الطَّيْرِ الْأَبَابِيلِ. You read Surah Al-Fil? أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ أَلَمْ يَجْعَلْ كَيْدَهُمْ فِي تَضْلِيلٍ وَأَرْسَلَ عَلَيْهِمْ طَيْرًا أَبَابِيلَ تَرْمِيهِمْ بِحِجَارَةٍ مِنْ سِجِّيلٍ. So he was mocking that. He said, where are the stones? Where are the birds? That is not what I'm saying. That's what Imam Ibn Kathir rahimahullah documented in year 317. Fast forward to our current time. Year 1406. 30 years ago. TNT explosives, they were discovered and confiscated from the Iranian Hajj group. You know, these were the peak of the Iranian revolution after Al-Khomeini came to power. This escalated. What happened? The pilgrims themselves, they say, we were surprised that the Hajj groups, they provided us with bags. Those bags were already having those TNT explosives. What surprised them is not the bags, because usually it is a gift. They give you a gift. What surprised them when they arrived Mecca, they told them, we want the bags back. Why? Because this is what they wanted. Alhamdulillah that this was discovered. But 1 year later, an incident in a different shape. Demonstrations from the Iranians with knives, swords, all weapons, white weapons they call, you could think of. They were chanting, death to America. Where was that? In Mecca. Why would you carry knives in Mecca and scream, death to America? Are there Americans there in Mecca? What do you make out of this? This was in year 1407. Year 1409, 19 from Kuwait and Saudi, from the Shia, were executed by Saudi authorities for the incident they caused. Because this year, 1409, they were successful. in bombings, two took place near Al-Aziziyah in Mecca. Two bombings took place. After investigations, they found out that those are responsible. 19 were executed. Mostly from Kuwait, 16 from Kuwait, and 3 from Saudi. All of them are from the Shia. In year 1410, the famous incident of the Al-Mu'aysim, the tunnel, Nafaq Al-Mu'aysim. Again, they released mustard gas, which killed around 1,500 pilgrims from Indonesia, Turkey, Algeria, and other countries. Do you see the pattern? You see the pattern? Not one time, not two times, not three times, but many, many times. These are some of the images. This is the demonstration that is taking place where? In Mecca. They are burning. They are, if you see the picture of Khomeini, they are carrying his picture where? In Mecca. These are the weapons, some of the weapons that they confiscated. Why would you bring this to Mecca? And call out death to America. Who's in Mecca? Muslims. But I will talk about that. This is another demonstration. You see the sign, Shari' al-Masjid al-Haram. This is the main street that is leading to Kaaba, to the masjid. They block the road. And those people, those men here, if you look at them, they have the badge on. You see the band on their left hand? They are from the Republic Guard. They are protecting their own people. The Saudi soldiers are back. Where back? There. Those are the ones that were executed. They're responsible for the crime in year 1409. Now, you see what they say about them, the Shia. What the Saudis did, they executed them for the deaths they caused. What do the Shia believe in those people? They call them Awliyaullah. Those people who killed the pilgrims to the Shia, they are considered what? Awliyaullah. And their visit is recommended. That's what they say. Ziyarat Awliyaullah. Assalamu alaykum. Awliyaullah wa ahibba'ah. Peace be to you, the friends of Allah. Now, we come to this year's incident, or actually last year, because now we are in a new year, in Muharram 1437. Initially, they announced about 760 people were killed, but the number kept increasing until over 2,000. What caused that? I don't know. I chose this topic and the title because this is something that you could remember. It just happened. And I want to ask you, do you remember some of the reports when people were asking what caused that? Let me ask you, have you heard that one of the rumors talking about the cause of this incident is that one of the Saudi princes was there and that caused, you heard that?
Yes.
Who's responsible for that? The Shia, because this is baseless. This did not happen. That is one of the reports. It is a rumor. They want to cover up on what happened. The incident was explained in full details on many news agencies that every Hajj group, they were given the time to come out to go and throw the stones. Iranians, they did exactly the opposite. In the main street that is going from Mina to the Jamarat, they went opposite direction. Not only that, when they came, they stopped. Now, it wasn't their time, it wasn't the right direction, they stopped. You, as a Hajj group, and another Hajj group, coming out and finding the way or the road is blocked, what do you do? This caused the people to go to a side road that is called 204. That's where the incident took place. And subhanAllah, most people who died were the ones who caused it. Many Iranians died as an instant punishment from Allah, subhanAllah. Many of them, some of them, I read the names, some of them are criminals. They are the cause for what is happening in Syria. They are leaders, ex-leaders in the Republic Guard in Iran. Now, some people say it's still the Saudis' fault. They should have managed, or they should have done a better job. Maybe. But let me ask you this. Just imagine a highway, and five people with five cars agreed to come simultaneously opposite direction. And the cars are coming, speeding, while you find five cars coming your way. What do you do? What happens? Whose fault is this here? You are talking about millions of people, more than 2 million. How can you control each one? There are videos from, I only showed you pictures here. These are only pictures. I have videos showing how people actually are talking and saying, why these Iranians are doing this? Wallahi, this is deliberate. Everybody is going this way and they are coming this way. You cannot appoint an officer for every pilgrim. That requires 2 million officers. So this is what happened. Again, I'm telling you, I'm not saying that there could have been better job. Yes, maybe, but you cannot control every single one. People were given instructions. They deliberately went against that. Now, the story does not end here. The aftermath is what is very dangerous. Because the next day, immediately, Iranians, officials, they came out asking for international custody over Hajj. This is the danger. Because this means the end of the Hajj that we know. This means allowing Muslims, non-Muslims, atheists, anyone to come. That is one of their goals. This is one of their purposes. And subhanAllah, Allah Azza wa Jal is just. When the Iranians, again, wallahi, I'm not defending Saudi Arabia, okay? I don't have any official ties with any people from there. Yes, I did study there. I love to be in Mecca and Medina, but that's all. 8 millimeters of rain. This is a joke here in Malaysia. MashaAllah, here it rains a lot. Tehran was flooded. It was flooded. So before you ask others to do a better job, you should look at yourself. Hassan Nasrallah, the leader of Hezbollah in Lebanon, it was simultaneous, it was organized. He also asked for international authorities to take over. He said, if Saudis cannot do a good job, let others take that job. I was yesterday in Lebanon, I just came. And I could tell you that the garbage is everywhere, literally. Who's controlling the country? Hezbollah. So you filled your country with garbage. You cannot even pick the garbage from the street. And you are talking about other people. You walk and you smell, wallahi, you smell the bad smell in the streets, in Beirut, and in southern Lebanon. Who's the cause for that? This guy and his people. And now he's talking about Mecca. Now I come to the important point of this entire talk. Why? Why all those incidents? From year 312 of Hijrah until year 1436 of Hijrah. Why? I chose only few passages from their books to clarify the matter. Brothers and sisters, it's not just a simple incident. This is something orchestrated on the highest level. This has much deeper purpose than a small incident and few deaths every year of Hajj. No. They consider their own places better than the Kaaba, the Shia. And that's why the existence of the Kaaba itself is a problem for them. Because when you say the grave of Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu is better than the Kaaba, and people are still going to Kaaba, how can you stop that? In order to stop that, you have to first destroy the Kaaba. This was the same thinking of Abraha. Abraha al-Habashi, when he built a church in Yemen, Al-Qulais. The same thing. Again, some might say, well, you are really biased. Don't take my word. Take only what they themselves say. That's from their books. I chose a passage from the largest book of tafsir. Just like our tafsir, everybody knows tafsir Ibn Kathir. They have a book called Bihar al-Anwar, over 100 volumes. Bihar al-Anwar. In that book, a narration from Ja'far. Of course, Ja'far rahimahullah did not say that, but that's what they claim he said. Kaaba praised itself and said, who is like me? Kaaba was talking that it is the holiest place on earth. So Allah Azza wa Jal inspired to the Kaaba and said, stop it, for there is a better place than you, which is Karbala. Karbala is the place where Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu was murdered, was assassinated. And that's from there, every Shia, when they pray, they have to have the stone. The stone is from the mud of that area, from Karbala. So to them, what is holier, the Kaaba or Karbala? Karbala, this is what they say. This is Bihar al-Anwar, volume 101, page 109. That's what they believe. They believe that Karbala is holier. So how come people are still going there? You have to stop them. And this is why it has been systematic what was going on. Another statement. What is the most authentic book for us, if I asked you? Quran. After the Quran. Book, not the book of Allah. From the...
Hadith.
Mm-hmm. What hadith? Sahih al-Bukhari. Of course, to the Shia, Sahih al-Bukhari is all fabricated. But they have a book as authentic to them as the Bukhari for us. It's called Al-Kafi. In that book, in Furu' Al-Kafi, what do they say? Visiting the grave of the Hussein equals 20 Hajj. 20 Hajj. And better than 20 Umrah. That's in their book. Volume 1, page 324. إِنَّ زِيَارَةَ قَبْرِ الْحُسَيْنِ تَعْدِلُ 20 حَجَّ وَأَفْضَلْ مِنْ 20 عُمْرَ وَحَجَّ. That's what they believe. So how do you tell your people, here it is better, but they are still going there to Mecca? You have to stop them. But that's not all. There is another reason also. Now this is their belief, but then there is another reason. Allah looks at the visitors of Al-Husayn, meaning the grave of Al-Husayn, before looking at his visitors in Arafah. This is in Al-Wafi, volume 2, page 222. The question is why? Why? When you tell this to someone, he would tell you this is nonsense. No, they have an explanation for that. They say, because all visitors of the grave of Al-Husayn are legitimate children. But the visitors on Arafah, they have children of zina. That's how they look at Ahlus Sunnah, at us. They consider us illegitimate children. To them, they are the only rightful children. See, again, someone would say, oh, this is too biased. This is what they have in their books. I never said a word without quoting what they believe in their books. Their belief in Al-Mahdi is one of the causes as well. And I'm telling you, the incident of Mina is only one of many. Don't think that next year there will be nothing. We ask Allah that there will be nothing. They will keep trying. That's part of their belief. It's just something that has to happen. There, because do we believe in Al-Mahdi or no? If you ask any person, do you believe in Al-Mahdi? Yes. What about the Shia? Do they believe in Al-Mahdi? Yes. But is their belief in Al-Mahdi different than our belief? Of course, it's not the same. Because our belief in Al-Mahdi is that when he comes out, he will fill the earth with justice. He will be just ruler. To them, they agree with that. But how justice is achieved, according to them? By killing us. We took the leadership from the rightful ones, from Ali radiallahu anh and his descendants. That's their belief. And therefore, the first thing Al-Mahdi will do when he comes out is to kill Ahlus Sunnah. That's in their book Al-Irshad, page 411. When Al-Mahdi comes out, he will destroy the Kaaba and cut off the hands of Banu Shayba. You know who are Banu Shayba? Banu Shayba are the trustees of the keys. The Prophet ﷺ gave it to Uthman ibn Shayba. And he told him, this will be to you and to your offspring until the day of judgment. Anyone who takes it from you is unjust. That's what the Prophet ﷺ said. What will they do when, according to them, of course? The first thing, that their hands will be cut off. And they will be called, these are the thieves. Why? What did they do? They took it from the rightful ones, from the family of the Prophet ﷺ. That's their belief. He will unleash a campaign to kill for 8 months. Al-Mahdi. Where is that campaign? In Mecca. Who goes to Mecca? Who goes to Mecca? We go there. So that's their belief. What comes next after Mecca? Medina. What will he do in Medina? He will take out the two bodies. He will uncover the body of Abu Bakr and the body of Umar radiallahu anhuma. And what will he do? He will crucify them. This is in the same book I told you, Bihar al-Anwar, the largest book, volume 52, page 386. That's their belief. So they will keep doing that. Their ultimate goal is to rid Mecca and Medina from the occupiers. You ask the Shia now, they tell you. Mecca and Medina, they are occupied by people worse than the Jews. That's their belief. That we're not Muslims. To them, we are not Muslims. Mecca and Medina, both are occupied. So they have to be liberated. That's why every single year, this will keep happening in a way or another. Now, why some years, as you noticed, Year 1406, 1407, 1408, 1409, 1410. And then there was a slight disappearance. And then it came out again. Why is that? Sometimes political influence also takes place. Sometimes. But that is their belief, which will not change. They consider the killer of Umar radiallahu anhu. I don't know if you know the incident of the killing of Umar radiallahu anhu. He was assassinated. By whom? By a Persian. His name is Abu Lulua al-Majusi. What do? In Iran, they built a big shrine, and they considered visiting that shrine is one of the best deeds. They call him brave man, Baba Shuja'. Who's Baba Shuja'? Abu Lulua, the killer of Umar radiallahu anhu. This is the entrance of the shrine. Have you heard of Sheikh Yusuf al-Qaradawi? You know Sheikh Yusuf al-Qaradawi, the chairman of the International Union of Muslim Scholars. He was asked in an interview, I saw that interview, by one of the sheikhs, actually it's his deputy, Sheikh Salman al-Auda. He asked him, what is the one thing that you regret doing in your life? Something that you regret. He said, I regret one thing, which is trying to bring close the Shia. He said, I regret that, because he thought that this is possible. Few years ago, in year 2006, in year 2007, there was war. Israelis, they launched a war against Gaza, and at the same time against Lebanon. Who was in Lebanon? Hezbollah. So Saudis did not support Hezbollah in Lebanon. Sheikh Yusuf al-Qaradawi and many other Muslims, they said, they are still Muslims, we have to support them. After the Syrian war, after the Iraqi war, after the Yemeni war, now you ask him and he tells you, it will be impossible. It's just impossible that we Muslims, Ahlus Sunnah, and the Shia be the same. This is the number one scholar. That's what he's saying. I want here to comment on another incident, since it is something that is happening now. Asifat al-Hazm, or the decisive storm. People ask, why Saudis are bombing Houthis in Yemen? Why Muslims are bombing Muslims? If anything, they should have attacked Israelis. Didn't that occur to any of you? Yes or no? What do you think? Yes, now we are talking a little bit politics, but actually it's all connected. It is all connected. What do you think, honestly? Is that right or wrong? What do you think?
I think it's not right.
It's not right. Why?
The Houthis are close to Islam. More close to Islam than...
Exactly. Houthis are more close to Islam. After all, they say La ilaha illallah. Yes or no? Muhammadun Rasulullah. They do say that. But their Islam is different from our Islam. Again, someone might say, oh, this is very biased. No, it is not. And let me tell you why. Years ago, Iran leased 3 islands from Eritrea. Eritrea has over 100 islands in the Red Sea. Do you know that? You don't know. These islands, Eritrea has been going through a very financial difficulty for years. So one way to overcome that, to lease those islands. Israel, this is something also maybe you don't know, Israel leased lands from those 100 islands. Why? They dedicate them for pasture, for livestock. All the meat that is eaten in Israel by the Zionists, it is from there, from those islands. While Iranians, why they lease those islands? To train the Houthis in Yemen. It is not about Yemen, it is about Mecca and Medina. That's what they openly said. This is why the Houthis, when they took control in Sana'a, it's very naive to think that they will stop. This was just the introduction. They will not stop until they reach Mecca and Medina. And that's why the Saudis, they had to stop it. One of their leaders, Al-Muhajir, one of the scholars of the Shia, he said, soon we will be taking control back in Mecca and Medina. The dreams that are successive and unanimous that the family Ahlul Bayt will be given back their rightful kingship. That's their belief. Now, I didn't talk about other beliefs, because in Quran, they disagree with us. They consider the Quran 20,000 ayah, three times what we have. And our students in Aris, they saw that. I showed them the text from their books. That's the Quran. If you believe that one letter is not from the Quran, one ayah is added, this is kufr. The Quran is protected, but to them it is 20,000 ayah. The companions, they disagree with that. They actually believe that the best of the companions, Abu Bakr, Umar radiallahu anhum, Uthman radiallahu anhum, all of them are apostates. They took the khilafah from Ali radiallahu anhu. They believe that killing us, Ahlul Sunnah, killing us is a good deed. Honestly, if you ask someone, who is closer to you, Christians, Jews, or the Shia?
Jews.
People generally would say Shia, because they are still Muslims. But if you think about it, actually, the ones that are closer to us, Jews and Christians, because we could live peacefully with them. The Shia, they will wait until time is right and they will kill you. You don't believe that? That's okay. But look at the world now. Look at what they are doing in Syria. Not only Syria. Look at what they are doing in Iraq. Look at what they are doing in Lebanon. They kill Ahlul Sunnah and they say, Ya li tharat al-Husayn. They are seeking revenge for the killing of al-Husayn. How? By killing us. How could you live with someone that his best deed is to kill you? The Jews and Christians, they don't have that. Yes, we disagree with them, but they don't have that. We could live peacefully with them. This is the danger. Even the Houthis, initially, they weren't that extreme. But after all these years of training by the Iranians, that's how they became. Houthis, initially, they are from Zaydiyah. Zaydiyah, the followers of Zayd ibn Ali. They are the closest to Ahlul Sunnah. Their only difference is that they believe Ali radiallahu anhu should be the Khalifa. But they don't claim that Abu Bakr or Umar radiallahu anhum are apostates. They are very close. So what turned them? It was Iran. Everywhere Iran goes, you can anticipate havoc and chaos. Lebanon, that's an example. Hezbollah there kept getting stronger and stronger until it is the strongest force there and the country is dead. Literally dead, Lebanon. Syria, the same thing. They go there and they say, we are protecting the shrines of the family of the Prophet ﷺ. How? By killing Ahlul Sunnah. Iraq, look at Iraq now. Americans literally gave it to the Shia in collaboration with Iran. What happened to the Iraq now? Destroyed. Yemen, the same thing. they will not stop. One of the diplomats from Kuwait, very well known politician, his name is Dr. Abdullah Nafisi. He was with a group of Majlis al-Ummah, it's like the parliament in Kuwait, visiting Iran. He was mentioning that because they are not shy to speak their beliefs. He said, we were visiting there and the food, all of it was meat. They kept giving us meat and I told them. He was speaking to Hassan Rouhani, who is now currently the president. At that time, he was the chairman of the foreign affairs in the parliament. So he was talking to him and telling him, it's all meat. Don't you have something smoother? Soup, fruits? He said, no, that's it. Later on, they brought him a cup with some noodles. It's called faludij. He told him, eat. So he ate. And he told him, what do you think? He said, yeah, this is good. This is smooth. He said, you are like that. Who are you? Us. He said, you are like that. You taste good and you are easy to swallow. And this is what we're going to do. They are not shy of saying that. We don't have the same belief. We still think that the Shia, the general ones of the Shia who don't know all of that, they are still Muslims because they say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. But their scholars, their beliefs in their books, definitely is, this is not Islam. So that is the problem. This is, brothers and sisters, what I wanted to point your attention to. The incident is not just isolated. The incident is not just small, as few Hajjaj, few pilgrims went there and this is what happened. This is very well organized. Nowadays we have ISIS. It's fueled by Iran. It's supported by Iran. Openly they say, we fight it, we fight terrorism, but under the table, they are supporting that. Because the bottom line is this, killing Sunnis by Sunnis. And if you could do that, why would you sacrifice your life? War and terror, the same thing. You don't find them imprisoning, killing the Shia. How many drones, how many attacks have we heard in Yemen before the decisive storm? And it was against Al-Qaeda, killing extremists. How many times you heard that Americans bombed Houthis? Never. It's always against us, against Ahlus Sunnah. Guantanamo does not have a single person from the Shia. It's all Ahlus Sunnah, again. So please do wake up and you need to realize that this is what is happening around the world. That's what I wanted to say in this hour. And I leave the rest. We have about half an hour for your comments and your feedback. Jazakumullahu khairan wa sallallahu sallam ala Muhammad wa sahbihi ajma'in. Yes, go ahead.
My question.
Yes.
I heard conflicting fatwas for Shia.
Yes.
They're not Muslim.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Why are they allowed in Mecca? There's history long history of that.
Yes.
So it goes back to the fatwa, are they Muslims?
Yes. Very good question. Are the Shia Muslims or not Muslims? We have to differentiate between two things. The belief and the individual. As individuals, now this same speech, if you mention it to Shia, many of them would say this is not true. We don't believe in that. And they might be telling the truth, because they might be not knowing. When you tell some of the Shia that you believe the Quran that our Quran, do you believe that it is altered, it is changed? They say no. So those people, you cannot call them kuffar. Why? Because they don't know. But their scholars are definitely kuffar. So to give one fatwa for all the Shia, this is incorrect. But to say the belief of the Shia itself is kufr, yes. Anyone who believed that the companions of the Prophet ﷺ are apostates is kafir. Anyone who believed that the Quran is changed is kafir. So their belief is definitely true. But as individuals, no. Some of them are kuffar and some of them are not. Now, why the Shia were not prevented? This question has been repeated a lot. And the Saudi government, as a country, has obligations. This is part of the charter of the Rabitat al-Alam al-Islami, Muslim World League. Iran is a member of that. So Iran, by right, has number to come to Hajj. So they cannot stop that on their own. They are trying. But still, even if they wanted, aren't there some of the Iranians that truly just want to go for Hajj? True. So this is, it is not easy. And if they did that, again now, it would be easier for the United Nations to intervene. And this is the last thing we want as Muslims, because everywhere United Nations is there, there is corruption. Our obligation as Muslims, now again, this is not in love for Saudi Arabia or the government or Al Saud, no. But it is in love for our Hajj, to keep it as it is. Because should something change, it will be terrible. It will be very dangerous. And that's what they are working on. That's what they are trying to do. Create chaos, try to repeat those incidents until the international community comes and says, well, you know what, we have to control that. So they will decide who will come and who will not come. I hope this answers the question. Jazakallah khair. Any other comments, any other questions?
How do you initiate this kind of discussion without making, without ourselves sounding like we're spreading hatred? I know we're talking the truth, but...
Exactly. How do you mention that without being considered biased or spreading hatred? One thing I love here in Malaysia is that officially, by law, it is not allowed to preach the Shia school of thought. Sometimes you have to put your foot and to legislate that. This is actually one of the good things that is happening here. I am really happy that finally officials realized the danger. As I told you, look around you, everywhere in the world, whenever Iran is involved, you can expect chaos. So this is the truth. Lebanon, Syria, Iraq, Yemen, even Turkey. Even in Turkey, they tried several times. So sometimes you need to legalize that, to legislate it, to force this. The reaction of people, it's up to them. Whatever they believe, because that's what they believe in their books. Now, is it our fault or their fault? There were many calls for dialogue. As I told you, Sheikh Yusuf al-Qaradawi himself, he was leading these efforts. But it was for no use. How do you talk to someone that he believes he can lie? He can lie. Lying is part of the religion. They call it taqiyya. So when they speak, you don't know. Are they telling the truth or they are lying? You don't know. That's part of their belief, at taqiyya. So, after all, you tell the truth. Yes, you try to be nice, but that's it. Any other questions? Yes.
I would like to share something. I heard a local scholar,
yes,
in Malaysia, this month, he had a talk like you, the same. I just need a clarification.
I hope it's not exactly the same. So.
He mentioned he went to Iran during the Shah of Iran.
Yes.
There was Shia also.
Yeah. Actually, the Shah was not Shia. The Shah was from the Sunnah, but anyways.
Then he came back again after Shah was,
yes,
killed. And the Shia was coming up,
yes,
more and more.
Yes.
So, the thing that I want to raise here, is it true that the Sheikh, the local Sheikh said, the founder of the Shia, the scholars you mean, the problematic ones,
yes,
are Jews. They are the Yahudis. He mentioned the names of the scholars that you mentioned on the top. Not only they are funded, they are the Jews themselves. So they give the names, I can't remember. So
I don't know of. I don't know of. But what I know is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned that the first followers of Ad-Dajjal, the Antichrist, 70,000 from the Jews of Isfahan, from Iran. Are there Jews in Iran? Yes. Are they practicing their religion freely? Yes. Are they members or founders? That's what I don't know. That's what needs confirmation. So there is no, to me until now, there is no evidence that Al-Khomeini, Khamenei, Rafsanjani, they are Jews. But are there Jews? Yes. In Iran, the majority are Shia, but not all. There is more than 10% of Ahlul Sunnah. There is an entire region. The one that is actually overlooking the Gulf, this is Ahlul Sunnah. It's called Al-Ahwaz, Iqlim Al-Ahwaz. They speak Arabic, but they are persecuted by the Iranians. You are not allowed to practice your religion. The only capital in the world that has no masjid for Ahlul Sunnah, Tehran. You can find churches, you can find synagogues, but to find a masjid for Ahlul Sunnah in Tehran, it's not allowed. It's not allowed. Many Muslims tried. Saudis are rich. Gulf countries are rich. They could raise funds. They asked to build a masjid, but it wasn't allowed by the authorities. In Moscow, there is Islamic Center. In Europe, all across Europe, but in Tehran, you will never find a masjid for Ahlul Sunnah. That's the truth. This is the truth. Any other questions? Yes. Could you please raise your voice? Yeah, that's the purpose of this talk, because many Muslims, they don't know. They say, oh, they are just like us. No, they're not like us.
A few years ago, I visited Tehran, and our friends brought us to this masjid.
Yes.
The first thing I noticed was there were a lot of shrines inside the masjid. But I didn't know, I went in and I prayed about the masjid. So when you say that Tehran didn't allow
the masjid is a masjid. You prayed with the jama'ah. You can pray. You can pray. I know by name imams from Ahlul Sunnah. Their hands were cut off. Their hands. Why? Because they were imams and they were leading the prayer like this, just like that. I'm not saying that you are not allowed to pray. You are allowed to pray. But Iranian officials will not allow building a masjid for Ahlul Sunnah. You could go to their masjids. You could pray there, your prayer. Yeah, that's allowed. What they do now, the embassies, all embassies, Qatar, Saudi, they have musalla. That's all what they could do because it is under the embassy. So this is international law. They can do whatever they want. That's where Muslims, they go there to pray in Tehran. Yes.
Can we know all this information?
Yes.
It sounds very depressing because I feel very helpless. I mean, ultimately, it seems that it's not just about Kaaba.
Yeah.
They are joining, collaborating with the, also with the Jewish to take control of.
Of course. Mutan, yes. Yes.
Control of Mutan.
Yes. Yes.
So, what are we doing? What can we do as Muslims?
What can we do? Jazakallahu khairah, that's the bottom line. We talked about all of that, we stated the facts. It sounds depressing, that's the truth. What can we do? First, there was, as I said, very excellent step, which is legally preventing them from preaching their religion. Because wherever they go, in Kuwait recently, they found a sleeping cell. Over 50 people with a lot of weapons. They were waiting commands from Iran. You ask the Shia in Gulf countries, they are Arab. They are from Qatar, from Emirates. You ask them, your loyalty to whom? They tell you to Iran. Okay, so first thing is to be prevented, because you look at them, there are many videos. I didn't show you, but there are many videos just showing you their practices, especially on the day of the 10th of Muharram, Ashura. How they weep, how they hit themselves. Why? Because it is the death of Al-Husayn. Yes, it was tragic, but Al-Husayn radiallahu anhu is not better than his father. Why don't you do the same with his father, Ali radiallahu anhu? He's greater than Al-Husayn. Why don't you do that for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? It's just pick and choose. So what can we do? Now, Iran is very smart. They are funding a lot of projects. They didn't just do that overnight. Whether it was in Yemen, as I told you, this was very sophisticated effort for years. So here in Malaysia, or any Muslim country for that matter, legally prevented them, but also financially. Look at the projects that they are involved in, that they are investing in. Don't support that. They keep talking about Iran and its war against Israel. One of the largest importers of chestnuts from Iran, Israel. So it's not helpful to say, well, we know that, but I'm still going to do business with them. You are funding them, and with your money, they are using it to kill Ahlus Sunnah, whether in Lebanon or in Syria or in Yemen or in other countries. That is one simple step that you could take. Raising awareness, that's very important. I'm telling you, the information that you heard today, have you knew that before? No. How many Muslims do you think they knew that before? Many or few? Few. And what I told you is much less than what I did not tell you. There is live streaming, so I cannot tell everything. I can just tell you to go and see what they are doing, what they are stating openly. They pride themselves that they will wait for the time to kill us. I hope this helps. Any other questions? Yes.
You relate to Malaysian environment. The Shia, I mean the Iranian Shia group, they are very influencing. And from my observation, they only penetrate the palace and they have their own mosque. And actually, I have two questions. Beside the element of faith, what their philosophy of faith that makes Malaysian people influence them? What's so influencing to the Malaysian community? Similarly, right? Secondly, I forgot.
It's good. Okay. So,
can you relate to the Malaysian environment? Why so influencing?
Their influence?
They have their own restaurant.
Yes. As I said, finances. They always do that. In South Africa, I was surprised to see that they invested more than $100 million in South Africa. Why? That's how they start. They do that as a project of restaurant, of trade, simple trade, carpets. Once they become strong, they started turning that to religious beliefs. That's how it is always. Now, one example is Brazil, for instance. Brazil has strong Shia community. And the West is encouraging that. I have heard many non-Muslims, when I talk to them, first thing they ask, are you Shia or Sunnah? This question on its own is offensive. I consider it offensive because you are considering Muslims 50-50, and that's not true. Just imagine when you talk to someone, you are a man, and you talk to someone and he asks you, are you gay or straight? It's exactly the same. Why? Because there are homosexuals, but their percentage is very low. But the world is trying to say that the Shia are almost 50%. They are less than 10%. They are less than 10%. But wallahi, almost everywhere I went, New York, Houston, California, they ask you, are you Shia or Sunnah? Who told you that Muslims are 50-50? The majority are Ahlul Sunnah. But this is our fault actually, because they are very strong, very organized. They are very generous to their cause. This is now another topic. I didn't want to talk about everything because otherwise it will be hours. They pay 20%. Our zakah is how much? 2.5%. And yet we are struggling with that. We are complaining. They pay 20%. One-fifth. They pay it. And their imams, their leaders are free to spend it the way they want. So that's how they are getting things done for them. So back here to the environment here. Look at the projects where they are investing in. Try to see what is the purpose after a few years, what's going to happen. Look at their communities, their gatherings. What is the purpose? They start with cultural day, awareness. They pride themselves in their Persian origin, not Islamic origin. When they speak about Iran, they say 5,000 years civilization. What is 5,000 years? We are in year 1437. That's not their beginning. They pride themselves in the Persian origin, the fire worshippers. I hope this answers the question.
Okay, they are going to get a lot stronger now because of the lifting of sanctions.
Yes, that is true. They are getting stronger, but you see, it is the nature, the sunnah of Allah Azza wa Jal, that there will be always a conflict between truth and falsehood. They are exhausted. And lifting of sanctions is like lifeline for them. Because they paid a lot of money in Syria, in Lebanon, and in Yemen, and they were losing. This is why the recent intervention of Russia took place. Because Iranians could not do anything for Bashar and his regime. So the lifeline from the West now is to lift the sanctions. It's only words. Death to America, death to Israel. It will never happen. They have a lot of relations with them. Their main target, us. Not the Zionists, not Americans, us. Yes.
The lifting of the sanctions, would that affect the fact that they have a nuclear weapon program?
Well, that's the purpose. After 10 years, not now, after 10 years. Yeah. Yes.
Okay.
Salam.
Earlier they were listing the number of terrorist acts committed by the Shia in
yes.
Iraq, right?
Yes.
But I didn't happen to see one particular incident, but I can't remember the history year, but I know the Common Era calendar year. It's I think 1979. There was siege of Mecca by Juhayman,
the man who
Is it in any way funded or influenced?
No. Jazakallah khair for this question. This is something that is different. What happened with Juhayman, because this is actually Saudis themselves, they believe that he is al-Mahdi. And that's why they took control. This is why I didn't also talk about another incident that took place in Mecca this year. Well, last year, on September 11th, the crane. Why talk about the incident of Mina, but not talk about the crane? Because it is different. The crane was there. Negligence could be. But there was huge wind. Very strong wind that it was not expected. So when Qadr happens, it is a mistake, something that is unexpected. It is different from something that is deliberate, that you on purpose did it. This is why the crane incident, yes, it was tragic, about 100 people died, but this was due to the extreme wind that were there. And it was Qadr of Allah. But this incident, when it is deliberate, people are standing deliberately and they know that there will be waves of people coming and they cause that, that is the danger. So the incident of Juhayman, that was different. That was from Ahlul Sunnah themselves. They thought that it is Al-Mahdi. Because we have in our belief that Al-Mahdi will be given the bay'ah, the pledge, in Mecca. So they thought this is the time. Any other questions? Any other comments? Yes.
If we have Shia friends,
yes.
Should we avoid them?
Of course. Of course, but it will be very difficult. Alhamdulillah, actually many of them are accepting Islam, but it's very hard. One of the hardest things to talk to someone that he believes he can lie and you don't know whether he or she is telling the truth or lying. Because taqiyya, that's part of their religion. That you could say whatever you want, as long as you believe it is beneficial for your religion, you're not accountable for the lies that you are saying. Yes.
How about marriage, Sheikh? Those days they discover, how about the status of the marriage day? We discover that Jalapati is actually raising to Shia.
Well, as I said, now you cannot generalize the ruling that all of them are not Muslims. And it is taking place. There are many families from Ahlul Sunnah, they are married to Shia. As long as you are practicing your religion and you are letting your children practice Islam, as long as that is happening, this is fine. I know one incident where the father was Ahlul Sunnah and the mother was from the Shia, but the children, now actually they live here. She's friend of my wife and she's Shia. Her father was from Ahlul Sunnah, but her mother was the influential one. So it is the father's fault in this case. It is happening. It takes place in Iraq, in Bahrain, in Syria, in Lebanon. It is happening. Now, is it haram? Depends. If the person's belief is strong, like in this, yeah, I would say it is prohibited. Outright, it is prohibited. But if they just say, we just have a different way of praying, we just have different preference, they are still Muslims. They say, La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah. So it depends. And to stay away from it is better. Okay, well, yes.
You mentioned in the Quran or in the Hadith about the Shia system, because it seems to be a big problem. Actually, how Allah says, or Prophet Muhammad says about the existence of the Shias, they may predict the Shia in the future. You mentioned the future, but the...
I don't understand. What is your question? Are the Shia mentioned in the Quran? On the Hadith? No. The word Shia means supporters. And the accurate word about the Shia, I say Shia because this is the common word, but the accurate word, the correct word is Rafida. Rafida, not Shia. Rafida meaning rejectors, because they rejected the bay'ah to Abu Bakr and to Umar radiallahu anhu. That's the accurate word. But they call themselves Shia supporters because they claim that they are the supporters of the family of the Prophet ﷺ. And in reality they are not, because it is pick and choose. They only chose few family members from the family of the Prophet ﷺ. Ali radiallahu anhu and his descendants. That's why they are called Al-Ithna Ashariya, the 12 Imams. Because they believe in 12 Imams. What about the other family members of the Prophet ﷺ, like Al-Abbas radiallahu anhu, his son Ibn Abbas? No, they don't get, so it is pick and choose. Is there mentioning about them in the Quran? No, just like any other deviant sect, they're not mentioned in the Quran. And this is actually one of the things against them. When you say, I am a Muslim, and that's enough. But when they say, we are Shia, they have to distinguish themselves. At the time of the Prophet ﷺ, were there Shia? At the time of the companions, were there Shia? So this is all new. Yes?
What are the possible preventive measure
in order to prevent them from further going in Malaysia?
Alhamdulillah, as I said, this is one of the good measures that legally they're not allowed to preach. They're not allowed to, because in some Muslim countries they were allowed, and they, whenever they are allowed, they go too far. In Kuwait, openly they do something, but under the table, in hiding, they do more things that are dangerous. They have their gatherings, the place called Husayniyah. Husayniyah, named after Al-Husayn ibn Ali radiallahu anhu. That's where they meet. That's where they give their religious talks. So to stop that legally, this is one of the excellent steps. Another preventive measure is not to deal in trade with them, to find alternatives. One of the things that I noticed here, the dates. Actually, they are cheap, Iranian dates. But you have alternative from Iraq, from Saudi. So this is something that should be considered as well. Yes.
Is it impossible for the Saudi to not to allow them to go for Hajj?
Well, the same question that was asked earlier, is it impossible? Not really impossible, but very difficult. And it would have greater consequences. Yes?
You mentioned that the, from your knowledge, the actual facts of the 2000 killed.
Yes.
Was it the group, the Shia that turned, included of the 2000 or included all the other Jama'ah?
Yes, yes, they are included. Because about 300 from the Shia who were responsible for that, they were killed. Why? Again, how do you cause something and then you become victim of it? When you deal with these large numbers, you can never expect the outcome. And that's exactly what happened. That's exactly what happened. You expected the people to have a stampede in that area, but it was just like flood that caught eventually to you. This is what happened. So they are included in that 2000. Yes.
How many times this kind of accident happened in the previous years?
Well, I just showed you at least 5 times. At least. And I said it will not stop, because that's part of their belief. That is part of their belief. Literally, some people, this is eyewitness. He saw some of the individuals there. They have sharp metals and they are throwing them. So when you, as a Hajj, you go, you are injured by that. They consider this is one of the best deeds. Any other questions? Any comments? Okay, we will have a graduation ceremony for the group of diploma later. If you want to stay, you're welcome to stay. Otherwise, Jazakumullahu khairan, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ala Muhammad wa ala sahbihi ajma'in. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.